Hi guys, James at Rampant Lion Reviews again for you today with another beer review. For this one, we are going to stick to Sweden and we're going to return to a brewery that's featured on the channel many times before. I've had some really nice beers from these guys over the years, a good few different styles, but if people were to ask me about this brewery, I would say that they're probably best known for doing quite a lot of different kinds of IPAs. Out of those IPAs, it's the black IPAs that always really stood out to me, but in the other IPA categories, they're pretty damn solid as well. I've had a good few Imperial Stouts from this brewery too, come to think of it, that have been pretty damn good. But yeah, the beer we're going to have a look at today is a style that I have had from them many times before, one that I know they can do well, and this is also one of the brewery's latest releases through Systembolaget here in Sweden too. So needless to say, I'm very curious to see what this one is going to have in store for us. Hopefully it's another good beer, hopefully it makes for an interesting review, and as always, I hope that you guys watching enjoy my take on this one as well. So for this review then, we are going to head up toward Gothenburg once again, Göteborg, as you would say in Swedish, the Swedish craft beer capital up there on the west coast. Got to get that Gothenburg catchphrase in when we're reviewing the Gothenburg beers, because it is just channel tradition these days. And for this review then, we are going to go to the Gamlestaden area, and we're having a look at another beer from Spike Brewery. So this particular beer is called Death Wish. It comes in at 7.5% ABV, and this one is a hazy IPA, a hazy double IPA, whatever you want to call it. 7.5%, in my opinion, is right on the edge of being a double IPA. So I guess we need to say a New England hazy imperial double, whatever you want to call it, IPA. But this beer was released as part of the Lokalt Osmoskolikt assortment through Systembolaget in Sweden for May of 2023. And I think this was the only beer they released this month, actually, if I'm not mistaken, although there could have been a few more. But yeah, always nice to return to Spike Brewery to try their new IPAs. We do this quite regularly. This is a brewery that I always keep an eye out for, because these guys do pretty damn solid beers. But yeah, let's crack on with this one then and do as we always do. So, as always with my reviews, I'll tell you a little bit about the brewery before we taste the beer. If you want to get straight to the tasting though, just fast forward. All the usual links can be found in the video description below. That's the brewery website, the link to my other reviews that I've done from Spike Brewery before, and we will no doubt add more to that list in the near future. But there's all the usual social media down there if you want to see more reviews. Do please consider subscribing to the channel. The support that you give is massively appreciated. And remember, you can go into the channel homepage and search for beer using the geography tagging system. So just go in there, use the search bar, put your hometown, state, county, whatever you like in there. And if I've reviewed beers from the area that you search for, they will pop up. Failing that though, you can check out the playlist of beers from different countries. You'll find this one in the Swedish playlist along with many other things, and we will no doubt continue to add to that over the next wee while. But yeah, let's go on to my brewery notes then, and I'll tell you once again about Spike Brewery. So, Spike Brewery, as I've mentioned to you already, are based in the Gothenburg area, Göteborg, up on the Swedish west coast, and the company was founded back in 2014 by Mats Westberg, Marcus Axberg, and Martin Johansson. So all three of these guys have previously worked together in the IT industry, although it is now only Mats and Marcus that are still active in the company. One of the big guys in the company these days as well is David de Sourcy, who joined the company and became the CEO. But the main brewer until March of 2021 was Bernardo Gava, who's from Brazil, and he trained in brewing at the VLB Institute in Berlin and joined the company in 2017. At the moment, these guys are producing around 250,000 litres of beer per year, and a good portion of that volume is actually used for contract brewing other breweries' beers as well. But the brewery itself can be found in the old Slakthus in the Gamlestaden area, which is to the north of the river, if I remember correctly. And they had an on-site tap room there as well, which was opening up on Saturdays and sometimes had food too. But they announced in November of 2021 that they were going to move to another unit just across from the first brewery, and the new brewery will be able to brew 500,000 to 600,000 litres of beer per year, and it's also going to have a 150-seater restaurant when it's completed. They'd already nearly completely moved into this premises by mid-2022, and they've now got Carl Janred brewing for them, who previously worked for Beersmiths and also under Bernardo Gava as well. But like I said to you, these guys, in, at least in my opinion, are really well known for their different kinds of IPAs that they do. We've had some good West Coasters, a lot of New England hazies. Any of the New England hazies, incidentally, that have business in the name always tend to be really, really good. But they've also got a good number of black IPAs, and the black IPAs I was always impressed with. But yeah, we've had a good few Imperial Stouts, one or two more kind of sour type beers from them as well that have been pretty nice. But yeah, not too many lagers, come to think of it, although I know they have produced a couple over the years. But yeah, a very solid all-round brewery these days, I guess we could say, but at least in my opinion, still best known for the IPAs. As of May 2023, though, when I'm filming this review for you, these guys have produced just over 160 different kinds of beer, and we've already just mentioned the styles and things like that. But yeah, that is everything I can really tell you about Spike Brewery for the moment. If you want to learn more about these guys, you can, of course, check out the brewery website. You can follow them on Facebook and Instagram to keep up to date with all the latest goings on, and you can check out the Untapped page to learn a little bit more about all the different beers that these guys have done as well. So yeah, let's go on then and have a little look at this beer. So as you can see, artwork on this one is quite interesting, a little bit different to what we've seen from Spike Brewery before, but you can see the Spike Brewery symbol down there. It's also on the side of the can too, which I think is nice. Then you've got a plain silver top there with a black pool to it. But yeah, says the Jacks in the Trade, Death Wish are about to get played. Death Wish is some kind of hip-hop song, if I remember correctly. But of course, hip-hop for me isn't heavy metal enough, so that's that. But yeah, to tell you about the beer itself, as I said earlier, it came out as part of the May release in Sweden for the local Småskalid, through Systembolaget. 7.5% IPA, that's why I believe it's a New England hazy, because it contains wheat and oats. And the hops in this one are Amarillo, Azaka, Mosaic and Talus, so it's going to have a big orangey hit, I would think. But yeah, all four of these hops are American. Amarillo is about 12% alpha acid, it gives you this big, oily, zesty orange thing. Azaka, about 14% alpha acid, that gives you quite a bright, kind of almost mandarin-y orange, but with also a bit of pineapple. Mosaic is a kind of nice, oily tangerine, 14% alpha acid again. And then Talus has this really interesting kind of pink, grapefruity thing to it, but it's also got a little bit of coconut underneath. It's derived from Sabro, actually, which is quite interesting. But yeah, interesting variety of things going on in this one. But yeah, let's have a little look at this beer then. We'll get it out into the glass and see what it's all about. So, there we go. It's poured pretty much as you would expect from a New England hazy, of course. Looks very, very nice. Definitely one of the darker ones, I can say, or one of the more rich-coloured ones I've come across over the last wee while. But yeah, in terms of the head on this one then, before, because that will disappear fairly quickly by the looks of it, you've got just over a finger of a kind of bumpy, I would say, cream-coloured head. One or two big bubbles, kind of sticking to the side of the glass in terms of carbonation too, a few little ones going up toward the bottom of the head, but overall it's quite bumpy. It does look very, very nice, this one. But yeah, so in terms of the colour of this beer, it's, yeah, as I say, a very kind of rich mixed fruit juice colour, that mixed tropical fruit juice, this one, I would say. So remember, the colour of your beer depends on a few things. One, the type of malts that you use. This goes a long way to determining your EBC rating. Two, length of your wort boil is also going to play a role, because the longer you boil the wort, the more the sugars caramelise, and thus you get a darker colour of beer. Any barrelation that you do or any adjuncts that you put in will affect the colour of the beer as well. But yeah, you can just... you don't often have to care about those two variables when it comes to different kinds of IPA. But yeah, you can see the level of haze on this one isn't too much. Remember, the level of haze depends on a few things. One, the type of malts that you use. This goes a long way to determining your EBC rating. Two, length of your wort boil is also going to play a role, because the longer you boil the wort, the more the sugars caramelise, and thus you get a darker colour of beer. Any barrelation that you do or any adjuncts that you put in will affect the colour of the beer as well. But yeah, as I say, it's good too. But level of haze... I've just repeated myself there. Brain went into automatic. Well, the level of haze in these beers depends on the oat content, wheat content, and to a degree what yeast you use. That's what I was going for. So, yeah, it can vary from brewery to brewery and recipe to recipe. But in terms of New England IPAs, this isn't one of the more hazy ones that you're going to come across. It's not too soupy and gloopy. You can see there's a little bit of opacity, opaqueness to this one, if we can call it that. I'm not actually sure what the grammatically correct word is, but my brain's always knackered these days, so I'm not going to hold it against it. Anyway, appearance-wise, this one is pretty much what you would expect of a New England hazy. Let's have a wee look at the aroma and just see what this one is all about. Yeah, this is pretty nice actually. So, as I've said in New England reviews before, for me, there are six different kinds of, or six different elements you should think about with the malty and yeasty side of these beers. So you've got the farmhousey yeasty side of things, you've got the rye and grainy side of the beer as well. Those two elements are a bit more common in American brewed New Englands, but then you've also got the wheaty bitiness, the barley malt bread, the oaty creaminess, and the sweeter side of things. When it comes to this particular beer, I'd say that this one's a really quite a barley malt leaning New England. It has got a little bit of wheaty presence to it and also a little bit of yeast, but for me the barley malt is the biggest, it smells like it's the biggest component within the beer. So yeah, I like this. I like how this one goes together actually. It is really quite nice in that sense. But the malty side of things is quite nice in this one. But generally speaking, nice wet grassy. The green component's nice and wet, but still quite fresh. We've mentioned the malty base in this one, and you've also got that kind of mainly orangey-leaning, fruity character. But overall, a very nice beer. But nothing too unusual about this one in terms of the style category that we're talking about. But let's break the beer down, describe that aroma a little bit more in depth, and we'll see how it goes together. So let's do this. So, in terms of the malty backbone of this one then, first thing you're going to get is that lovely, fresh, white bready bread crust coming out of the beer. Fresh, white bready bread crust. The way that that goes together is really quite nice. There's a little bit of Jacob's cream cracker coming out on top of this one too, as well as a little bit of a kind of woody character, which I do really enjoy. So, aroma-wise, as I say, this one was really, really nice, actually. It's on top of that, you get lots of kind of fluffy white bread. Bread crust, a little bit of Jacob's cream cracker, a little touch of woodiness in there. There's actually a wee touch of wholemeal brown bread, I would say, as well. Then you've got the fluffy white bread. And then on top of that, you can smell a bit of the wheat. The wheat in this one, it's interesting. At the back of the nose, it's got a little bit of bitiness coming out of it. So a little bit of bitiness from the wheat at the back of the nose, but otherwise you've got quite a little bit of smoothness coming out of this one. And then you've also got... You've also... got a nice little bit of you can smell a wee bit of the oaty character in this one, and the oats are interesting because I actually find in this one the oats come across as being quite dry, but I still get the impression from the aroma it's not too much of an oat forward beer actually, or an oat forward New England IPA. So the thing with oats is they can usually be used as a they can be used as a rough indicator of how old your New England IPA is. So the younger the beer is, the creamier. The oats will come across as being, but the older it is, the drier they'll get. So this is always an interesting point with this particular style of beer. But for me, the oaty creaminess in this one, it's mainly dry actually. I really don't know how fresh this beer actually is, but it says it's best before the 4th of April 2024. So it must be about six or seven weeks old at this point that we're drinking this one, because it's probably been canned on the 4th of April 23. But yeah, You can smell the oats are starting to get a little bit dry in this one. But I would say that for the age of this beer, the oats smell drier than other ones I've had within this category. But I suspect that could just be because there's not so many. There's not such a big volume of oats in this particular beer. But, yeah, we just need to see. On the malty side of things, you've also got a good little bit of sweetness out of this one. A little bit of a kind of Werther's Original butter candy, butterscotchy sort of thing. But the sweet component in this beer is not overly big. When it comes to the green component of this one, as I said earlier, it's got quite a big, fresh green component to it, this one. This is common with New England IPAs. So when you hop IPAs, you have three different types of hoppings that you can do. Let's use a 90-minute wort boil as the model to explain. So within the first hour of the wort boil, that is early addition hopping. That gives you a lot of bitterness usually, but also a kind of deep and dank aroma. Late addition hopping, which comes within the last half hour of the wort boil, that gives you a little bit of bitterness, but mainly flavour and aroma, and that gives you a nice kind of bright green component in the nose. Then dry hopping after the wort boil is complete, that gives you all flavour and aroma, and then again it contributes to a brighter green component in the beer. So yeah, the way it goes together in that sense is really quite nice. So yeah, the green component in this one for me, there's a little touch of earthiness which will be coming from the mosaic. You have got a nice kind of big bright grassy zesty sort of thing, which is good. Yeah, nice big bright grassy zesty sort of thing on this one. Good little bit of, as I say, there is a tiny touch of dankness to this one, but I'd say it's more a spicy floral note and a bright grassy zesty character that comes out of this beer. So, yeah, the way this one goes together, I think, is really, really nice. On the fruity side of things, then, it is kind of pretty much as you would expect from these hops. You've got a little bit of coconut just underneath everything, but then you've got the big orangey character. You get the more oily, zesty orange from the Amarillo, and then you get the sharper, brighter one from the Mosaic. You get the kind of juicier tangerine from the Mosaic, and then you get the sharper one from the Azaka, of course. But there's a wee touch of pineapple in there, and you can smell the pink grapefruit behind everything else too. So, yeah. The way that this beer goes together, I think, is really quite nice. Yeah, interesting stuff. I have to say, it does go together very, very well. So, yeah, as I always say, take a little bit of time and enjoy the aroma of the beer before you get stuck into it. But we're going to see how this goes together then. Oh, there's a wee bit. Was that a wee bit of sediment in this one? Yeah, there's a wee bit, one or two little bits of wheaty sediment in this beer. There you go. You can see that at the bottom. So yeah, this one obviously has been sitting for a little bit. Hopefully at the right temperature though. Yeah, you can see there is a wee bit of sediment in this one anyway. But yeah, as I always say, take a bit of time to enjoy the aroma of your beer before you get stuck into it. But I think it is about time that we taste this one and see what it's all about. So yeah, pardon me, this one is the Death Wish 7.5% New England Hazy Imperial Double, whatever you want to call it, IPA, from Spike Brewery in Gothenburg, Uteborg, up on the Swedish west coast. Let's get stuck in. Slange, skål, cheers. Yeah, pretty solid once again from Spike. Fruity side of this one's right up my street though. The big orangey characters are just lovely. Do enjoy this. But yeah, this is pretty damn nice, I have to say. Yeah. Gives you everything you'd want from the style, actually. In terms of the New England style, though, this one, for me, it's one of the more oily New Englands I've come across. Quite bready as well. Good little bit of hoppy green component to it, which I like. It does give you a wee bit of bitterness into the aftertaste, and then just big, yeah, oily, juicy, fruity character. So it's a big thumbs up for me. This is a really nicely done beer. So, happy enough with this, have to say that. Yeah. Let's try and break this one down then and just describe it a wee bit more in depth. So, For me, the the multi backbone of this beer, if we go to the middle third of your palate with this one, we'll start there as we always do. The backbone of this beer, you've got that lovely, fresh, white bready bread crust with this one there. I really do like how that goes together. As you move further forward on that, as you move further forward toward the front of that middle third of your palate, you've got a nice little touch of woodiness in there, and then above the bread crust incidentally does get a little bit drier the further into the aftertaste you go, but then you've got a more kind of crackery note coming out of this one, which is really nice. So, above the kind of bread crusty notes, like I say, you've got a layer of kind of Jacob's cream cracker, and then above that, you've got a bit of a kind of wholemeal, brown bready sort of thing coming out of this one. And, yeah. The kind of brown wholemeal bready type things that are coming out of this one are really, it's quite sweet actually. You do get quite a little bit of sweetness out of the wholemeal brown bready character in this beer. And then above that, you start to get the kind of white bready characters. And the whole bready note that you get in this beer actually is nice and sweet. And the more that you drink of this beer, generally speaking, the more sweet character it shows you. So yeah, you've got a fluffy white bready layer, then you can feel the layer of wheat above that one, which has a nice little bit of density to it. And then on top of the wheat, you've got a more oaty note out of this one. So going down the middle line of your tongue, you've got a more kind of dense, creamy, oaty character. The oatiness does have a little bit of creaminess to it, but I think this just doesn't strike me as being an overly oat-forward New England IPA. So as you move out toward the edges, of that middle third of your palate, you start to get the more, you start to get more dryness out of the oats, but in the dead centre of that middle third of your palate, there's a wee bit of a kind of oily, there's a more sort of oily, kind of Werther's Original butter candy, butterscotchy type thing coming out of the beer, and then as you move out from that, you've got more of a McVitie's digestive biscuity character coming out of this one too. So, the way this beer goes together in that sense is very, very nice. So, the way the beer goes together in that sense is pretty good. I would say the other thing as well is potentially the further into the aftertaste you go with this beer, in the centre of your palate, you get a wee bit more of the kind of sweet caramelly notes and the Werther's Original underneath, and then you've got the McVitie's digestive biscuit. So it's pretty good how it goes together. Actually, it's pretty nice. On the other than that, I think that's everything we need to say about the middle third of your palate. Let's go to the back third of your palate then. So the border region between middle and back third of your palate, you've got a nice little bit of kind of bready build-up in there. Nice little mix of white and brown bready character in there. The base of that back third of the palate, you get the bread crusty character again. And what I've always said about the back third of the palate is the types of flavours you get are quite similar, but they just come out in different intensities. And as I've always said, more dry and bitter flavours come out further back on the palate. So sweeter flavours come out further forward. So the bread crusty base that you get on that back third of the palate, the bread crusty base in that back third of the palate that you have is a good little bit drier and a good little bit more, it's almost kind of like toasty. Above that, you've got a wee bit more of a kind of wholemeal brown bready character coming out of this one. And then above that, you've got the that you can feel the wholemeal brown bready character is a lot more kind of light and airy. Then you've got the fluffy white bread above that, which is light and airy. But both of these bready notes still have a little bit of sweetness to them. And then above that, you get the wheat. And at this point on the back third of the palate, the wheat is giving you a good little bit of bitiness. And then above everything else, you have the more kind of yeasty notes coming out of the beer. So a nice kind of farmhousey bready character, which is great. But yeah, the way that this goes together is pretty nice in that sense. So you've got that nice farmhousey bready character in there, kind of sweet McVitie's digestive biscuity character as well. And yeah, the way that that goes together is pretty nice. So the back third of your palate, as you can see, the flavour is definitely taller. Then as you come further forward into the middle third of your palate, just kind of condenses down and squashes together. But the sweetness and the mix of stuff you get going on in the sweetness and the mix of stuff that you get going on in the malty and yeasty side of things in this beer is really, really nice. Yeah, the way this goes together is pretty damn good. In the back corners of the palate, you've got a nice little bit of earthiness in there. As you move further forward, you get a little bit of floral aromaticity, and as you push forward toward the front of that, the front corners of your palate, you do actually get quite a spicy floral aromaticity out of this one. And in honesty, if I was tasting this beer without knowing the hops, I would have guessed there was a little bit of Columbus as a bittering hop in this one, because it does give you a fair little bit of a spicy floral aromaticity, which I think is very, very nice. Round the front curve of the palate, you've got the lighter, grassy sort of thing. It's kind of it's a bit of an oily, grassy character that you get out of this one. It's quite nice in that sense. So yeah, wee bit of earthiness from the mosaic, as we said. Quite a lot of spicy, floral aromatic sort of things, and then an oily, grassy component. I think that describes the fruity, the hoppy green component of this beer pretty well. But let's round off with a look at the front third of the palate and the fruity side of things then. So the border region between front third and middle third of your palate, you've got that nice little bit of bready build up in there, mix of white bread and brown bread, and it has got a bit of sweetness there. The base of that front third of your palate has the bread crust, and it's got a little bit of a kind of crackery note on top of it, brown bread and white bread. Then you get that nice oily bubble where the juicy fruity esters roll their way out of the beer. So yeah, the way that that goes together is pretty nice. But yeah, I do like how that goes together, sure. This beer when I saw the hop bill on this one, I didn't know it before I bought it. When I saw the hop bill, I'm just like, yeah, I'm going to probably going to enjoy the fruity character in this one, and it is really good. At the back of that, front third of your palate, you do get a nice little bit of a strong kind of pink grapefruity note. And then as you move further forward, you can feel the beer just gets more and more orangey. There's a little bit of an oily pineapple in there, which is going to come from the Azaka. The pink grapefruit, of course, is going to come from the Talus. But then, yeah, as you move further forward, you get more and more orangey character. You can feel the big zesty, oily orange from the Amarillo in the base. You've got the juicier tangerine, and then the kind of more zesty mandarin-y character from this one. So, yeah, the Amarillo's giving you the more oily notes. The Mosaic's giving you the kind of juicier one. And then above that, it's the kind of mandarins from the Azaka. But beautiful fruitiness on this one. I really do like how this pieces together. Yeah, I like this one. I really do like how this pieces together, actually. It's a thumbs up from me. Yeah, I have to say it's a beer that's grown on me, this one, the more that I've drank of it. It's got a little bit more floral character as time has gone on. It's got a lot more oily, orangey zest to it, which is great. And then you've got a nice kind of bready, grainy character too as well, which I think is really good. So, yeah, I like this one. It does get a big thumbs up from me. Yeah, interesting stuff from Spike, but enjoyable beer. quite different from the New Englands that I've had in recent times, I have to say. So let's round off with a wee look at the mouthfeel. In terms of the mouthfeel then, I would say that this beer is... from mid to the top end of mid-bodied, the carbonation is very, very smooth. It's got a nice kind of oily mouthfeel to it, and it's got a nice, like I say, kind of bready smoothness coming out of it as well. So, yeah, it's good, this one. It has got that, it's not such a creamy New England IPA, it is more of a kind of oily and slightly bitter New England in that sense. The malt base, like I say, it's got a bit of graininess underneath, it's got a bit of smoothness and it's got a bit of sweetness. Big kind of green component to it as well. Like we say, this beer does have a little bit of bitterness. I would say this is maybe 40 IBUs. It just feels like it's a little bit more than the standard 30. And you've got a wee bit of zestiness to the green component as well, and then the nice kind of oily, fruity characters too. But a very solid New England IPA from Spike, which, to be honest, is what I would expect from this brewery. I know they're quite well versed in this this particular style. So, yeah, I think we can leave it at that for this one. So, yeah, this was the Death Wish, a 7.5% New England double IPA from Spike Brewery. Really enjoyed this one. Quite different to what we've had in recent times. But, yeah, once again, thank you for watching my beer reviews. Until the next time, please like, subscribe, share, all the usual YouTube stuff. Let me know your own thoughts on this beer in the comment section below. Let me know what your favourite beers are from Spike Brewery as well. And we will no doubt return to these guys again at some point in the very near future. But until the next time, Slange, Skull, cheers, and see you guys in the next one. Check out my social media and check out Spike's social media.